Deserted, every god's altar is drenched in blood. The city's king Priam is himself lying slaughtered at the steps of Zeus's altar in his own palace. The altar of Zeus, the protector of his palace. Mountains of plunder, Trojan gold, and spoils have been loaded onto the Greek ships. They're waiting there now. The Greeks who have brought war to this place, they're waiting for a favorable wind to help them sail back home. Their hearts gladdened by the hopes that they'll see their wives and their children. They've been away from home for 10 long years. And as for me, now that Hera, goddess of Argos, as well as Athena, the goddess of Athens, now that these two goddesses have fought me and have beaten me, I must leave this glorious city and all of my temples and be on my way. These two goddesses have conspired against Troy and all her people. They have conspired, and they have won. You see, when a city suffers, so do her gods. The people no longer have the time nor the mood for holy devotion. We, the gods, suffer. The river Scamandros echoes violently with the sounds of the women who must wait for fate to tell them whose slave they are going to. Some will serve the men from Arcadia, while others will be slaves to the men from Thessaly. Others still will serve the sons of Theseus, king of Athens. Then there are those who haven't been told their lot yet. This lot of women is waiting here in these huts. Among them is Helen, daughter of Tyndareus, king of Sparta. Now that woman is no greater than any of the other slaves, one of a great many captives. Quite right, too. If anyone cares at all about that one there, the queen of the city, well, there she is, Hecuba. She is lying by her city's gates, shedding floods of tears. Her grief is great. The disasters that befell her many. Her daughter, Calexina, was gruesomely slaughtered upon the grave of Achilles, slaughtered as a sacrificial offering to Achilles. Her husband, her king, the city's king Priam, and all of her sons, all of them are slaughtered. Her other daughter, Cassandra, whom Apollo had made a prophet and left. was taken by that arrogant king of the Greeks, Agamemnon, to sleep with him in his own bed. A dire violation of all the laws of his religion. Well now, Troy, I bid you farewell. You too, fabulous towers, you would still be standing there proudly had not Zeus's daughter Athena destroyed you all.
Poseidon! You are a great god, Poseidon, honored amongst all the other gods, and you're the closest relative I have on my father's side. So could we now put aside this hour-old grudge and now exchange a few friendly words?
Of course we can, my lady Athena. The kind exchange of words between family members always has a mighty magic effect upon the heart.
I applaud your calm disposition, my lord Poseidon. And I bring to you news that is of equal interest to us both.
Have news from the other gods? Zeus, perhaps, or some other divinity?
No. No. I've come to talk about Troy. The very land we're standing on right now. I've come to ask for your assistance.
Ah, you're feeling remorse now, Athena. Now that you see Troy in flames and smoke, you won't forget about the hatred you once had for her. Now you're feeling sorry for her, is that it?
Give me the answer first, Poseidon. Will you help me? Will you work with me on my plan?
Of course. Of course I will, but tell me first, though, who is it you want to help, the Greeks or the Trojans?
I want to give joy to the Trojans. I know, I hated earlier. But now I want to make the homecoming of the Greek soldiers a bitter experience for them.
How can you do that, Athena? I mean, how can you just go from excessive love to excessive hate at the slightest whim of fate?
Aren't you aware of how these Greeks have treated me and my temples? Total and absolute disrespect!
I know. Ajax dragged Cassandra by force.
A word from the Greeks. Not a single reprimand. No one reproached them for it!
But it was you who have helped the Greeks beat the Trojans. They did it with your own powers, Athena.
In any case, it is them I want you to help me punish.
Ready to help? What have you got in mind?
I want them to suffer a terrible journey home.
What, you mean now while they're still on land or afterwards when they're in the middle of the ocean?
Once they leave Troy and set sail for their country, Zeus will let loose a deluge of frenzied rain and hail and all the turbulent black winds he can muster upon them. He said he'll give me his lightning bolt to strike at all the Greek ships with them all on fire. As for you, I want you to stir the Aegean waters into huge cyclones and typhoons, fill the Euboean Gulf with floating corpses. Let them learn a lesson about honoring the sacred temples.
All this shall be done. No need to waste more words upon it. I shall make turbulent all the waters of the Aegean Sea and hurl many corpses upon the Cape of Mykonos and upon the wild crags of Delos and Lemnos. But go now, Athena. Go up to Mount Olympus, the gods' abode, and get the lightning bolts from the hands of our father Zeus. Go on now. The mortal who sacks the city and destroys its temples and its graves, the sacred homes of the dead. It's a fool, because his own destruction will certainly follow.
No longer a queen, Hecuba. Hold tight, Hecuba.
stay strong while fate changes her way. Accept her path. Follow it. Sail with it. Don't turn your prow against your life's tide. Sail on. Fate will steal your life's ship. How can I not groan in pain when I have lost it all? Everything. My country. My children. My husband. Mountains of glorious wealth passed on to us from many generations. All of it vanished now. Now it is nothing. What words am I forbidden to utter? What words am I forced to say? How heavy is my grief? What should I mourn? Oh, oh, my back. Oh, lying on this hardened mattress, all my limbs are aching. Oh, the aches and pains and on my shoulders. Oh, the temples of my neck. Oh, my ribs. Oh, I wish I could turn a bit this way. No, no, that way. Oh. Endless groans, endless tears. A lullaby for the unfortunate. A dirge without a dance to mourn misfortune. Prows of swift ships. The oars of men guided through the purple waters of the ocean. From the quiet harbors of Greece all the way here to the sacred city of Troy. Still hear it. The screeching of your dire trumpets mingled with the sweet sounds of our gentle flutes. You came and hooped your Egyptian-plated ropes onto Troy's harbor. What for? To do what? To take back that hateful wife of Menelaus. Light upon her brother Castor's name she is, and a stain upon that of her father Eurotas. That woman who slaughtered Priam, the father of 50 sons. That woman who has hurled so much black misery upon me. Me, Hecuba, the fabulous queen of Troy. Now here I am, sitting by Agamemnon's huts, a slave. I am now an old woman, part of the conqueror's miserable plunder. Come out, you women. Come, come and weep with me. Come, come, you wives of soldiers, Trojan soldiers, experts in the ways of the bronze spear. Come, come, you women unfortunate in marriage. Let us weep for the destruction of our city. Look at her, look. She is choking in smoke and ashes. Come, come, let me be like a mother bird who teaches her fledglings how to chirp. Let me begin the song. It won't be a song like those I sang when Priam held his scepter, and when the proud feet of a chorus stomped their beats in praise of our city's gods.
Hecuba, what is it? What are you saying?
Why are you crying? What do your words mean?
I could hear your sad speech in the hut.
Panic spins in the hearts of the Trojan women. bring out my daughter Cassandra. Don't bring my daughter out here. She will be seized by one of her frenzied attacks again. She will just embarrass me in front of the Greeks. I'm no more to fight Calamity. Poor unfortunate Troy. You are lost, and lost too are those who leave you, whether they are alive or dead.
I'm trembling with fear. We heard you crying from inside Agamemnon's hut, Hecuba. Tell us, have the Greeks decided to kill us? What's news from the Greeks? Have the Greeks taken their oars down from the sterns of their ships?
Darlings, I was out here all night, out of my wits with fear.
Have the Greeks sent a herald for us?
Whose slave will I be, poor wretch?
Your lots will be drawn any minute now.
Will it be a soldier from Argos or from Phthia or from some other island country? Who will be my master, I wonder? I am sick with fear.
Old and withered soul. Useless like a drone at death's door, a ghost in the underworld. Who will be my master and where? What will I be doing? Will I be waiting at their guests? Or will I be a nurse for the master's children? Me, Hecuba, the honored queen of Troy.
What lament would do justice to your pain, Hecuba?
Or to mine, that will no longer send the shuttle up and down the Trojan loop. Look, there. This is the last time I can look upon the corpses of my sons.
Worse still will come. Dragged to the bed of a Greek. A curse upon such a night.
A curse upon such a fate. Or else to carry water, like a miserable slave from the sacred springs of Pirene. Oh gods, at least take me to that blessed and welcoming land of Theseus.
But never, gods. Never make me a slave to that murderous Helen, or to Menelaus, the destroyer of Troy.
I couldn't bear to look at them again. Never take me to their hateful home by the torrents of the river Eurotas.
I've been told about a land nearby, that one by the graceful foot of Mount Olympus.
Peneus' blessed land, wealthy and fertile.
There I'd like to go, though I must.
But not before I go to Theseus' sacred country. And I've also been told about Hephaestus' fiery land, Etna,
across from Carthage, mother of Sicily's mountain range.
Heralds have spread news around the world of how they crown their victorious athletes with glory.
And across from that place, as the sailor cuts through the Ionian Sea, he'll come face to face with another land.
Yes, a land where the famous waters of Kratos flow.
I've heard these waters give your hair a golden glow.
They nourish the whole country, these waters.
And raise splendid men.
Look, I can see a herald hurrying here from the Greek camp.
I wonder what message he'll be delivering to us. He'll tell us that we're now the slaves of the Greeks.
Hecuba, I've made many trips to Troy to deliver messages to you from the Greeks, so you know me. That's why I came in person to deliver to you this new message.
It is here, friends. It is here. The dreadful news we've been awaiting all this time is here.
The news is that the draw has now been completed. You've all been allocated to your Greek masters. Was that what you were afraid of?
Oh. Well then, where are we off to? Someplace in Thessaly? Or Phthia, one of Cadmus' countries?
You're all each drawn into a different man. You are not drawn as a lot.
Well then, who was allotted to whom? Which among us Trojan women are the lucky ones?
I know who goes with whom, but ask me about individuals, not groups.
Tell me, please. Who has drawn my unfortunate daughter Cassandra?
She was Agamemnon's special prize.
So she will be the Spartan woman's slave? What misery!
No, not a slave to her, but a secret bed partner to him.
Cassandra. The very priestess of the god with the golden arrow, Apollo, but the god with himself dressed for the gift of a virgin's life.
Eros has pierced the king's heart with his arrow, and now he's in love with the godly woman.
Throw away the keys to the shrine. Take off the holy garlands that adorn your head.
What are you saying, woman? Is she not blessed to have won the king's bed?
And the last daughter you took from me. What of her? Where is she?
Who you mean? Polyxena or some other one?
Yes, Polyxena, that one. Where is she?
Her draw is to serve Achilles too.
My daughter? To serve a tomb? What is this? Some Greek custom or a law? Tell me, friend!
Just be happy for your daughter. Her fate is good, that's all you need to know.
Her fate is good? What does that mean? Is she still alive? Can she still look upon the light?
She is in the hands of fate. So she is released from pain.
And what of the wife of the glorious soldier Hector? What about Andromache? What is her fate?
Achilles' son took her as his special prize.
And me? What of me? An old woman with an old head who must add a stick to her 2 feet to walk on 3. Whose slave will I be?
You'll be serving Odysseus, king of Ithaca.
Beat at your shorn head, Hecuba. Tear at your cheeks with your nails. You must now go in and be the slave of that loathsome reptile of a man, the lawless and poisonous snake. His double tongue shuffles things about this way and that. He turns love into hate and hate into love. He topples everything upside down. Oh, Hecuba, what fate rules you? Come here, women, come, come and weep with me. Now I am gone. I am destroyed. I have drawn the most unfortunate lot.
You know your fate, Hecuba, but what about mine? Who has got my lot in his hands? An Achaean? A Greek?
Come, come, slaves. It's time for you to bring out Cassandra. Hurry, before I take the rest of those whose lot has been drawn to your Greek masters. What's this? Torchlight? Fire? Are the women setting fire to their homes because they'll be sent to Greece, or are they setting themselves on fire? Do they prefer death to life? It's a hard thing for the free to put their heads into the yoke of slavery in times of such misfortune, I know, but... Open up! Open the door! I hate to be blamed for something that's good for these women, but bad for the Greeks!
No one is setting anything on fire! It's just my daughter Cassandra rushing about! She is possessed by divine madness. Lord, God of marriage, Hymenaeus, Lord, Hymenaeus! Here, lift it up, up high. Cover me. Here, bring the light here. Lord, God of the wedding bed, Hymenaeus, I bring you light with the fire of the torch. I bring light to this holy temple.
Sure.
strength, Ireland. This divine madness won't let you stand still. And your unfortunate fate has not made matters any easier for you. Come, friend. Come, take these torches inside. Greet her wedding songs with tears.
fate was a bitter one, but listen! This is how things actually are. He has died gloriously, and with the reputation of a very brave man, a reputation he owes to the Greeks, because had they not turned up, and no one would have known about his bravery. And Paris. Paris took wife Zeus' very own daughter. Had he not done that, had he married some other woman, then who would have known about him or his house? But of course, people with any sense at all would avoid war. If war does come, the glorious deaths are no garlands of shame for a city, though to die shamefully would be a disgrace for it. So, mother, don't feel sorry for our city or for my marriage, because through my marriage, I shall destroy those who we both hate.
Oh, how you laugh in the face of misfortune, Cassandra.
In the face of a misfortune that will destroy your whole house.
How you love to prophesy things that cannot happen.
I swear, woman, had not Apollo maddened your mind, I'd have you punished for sending my generals off on their journey home with such ominous prophecies. But still, it seems that those of us with fame and intelligence are no better off than those with none. Because here, we have the great general of all the Greeks, the beloved son of Atreus, falling in love with this mad woman here. Our great Agamemnon has chosen her above all the other Trojan women. Now, I may not be as rich as he is, but I would never have chosen her as my mistress, that's for sure. And you, Cassandra, since your mind is not well, I have decided to cast all of your praises for the Trojans and all of your curses for the Greeks to the winds. Let the winds carry them where they may. But now, pretty bride, follow me to the ships. My commander's bed awaits you too, Hecuba. When Laertes' son Odysseus calls for you, follow him. Those who have come to Troy say you'll be the servant to a very wise woman.
And what a great servant you are. A truly excellent servant. Why do they call them heralds, I wonder? These men who hover about the service of kings and cities, criers of death. The whole world hates them. You say my mother would be Penelope's servant? Well, what of Apollo's prophecies then? Revealed to me that she will die here in Troy. I won't go on reproaching you for the rest of what you said. Poor Odysseus. He has no idea what's in store for him. The suffering he'll go through will make mine, and that of Troy, look like pure gold, luxury. Worthy of many tears. His journey home will be much delayed by the Charybdis, that gruesome beast that dwells on the rocks of the gorge that he must pass through, and by the mountain lion, an eater of human flesh and silence, and by the Ligurian Circe that turns men into pigs, and by ships getting wrecked in the vast and salty sea, and by his lust after the lions, and by the frightening human sounds, the slaughterhouse of the unknown will make a bitter disease is here! Shorten the narrative, folks. Odysseus will enter Hades after he escapes from the waters of the wide ocean. He'll arrive home where a million evils will welcome him.
Why do I bother singing the catalogue of Odysseus's pains?
Come, hurry up, then. I shall marry my husband, Hades! Oh, Agamemnon, chief of all the Greeks! How glorious your fame!
where's your general's ship? Which way do I climb aboard? Come, come, Harold, don't waste any time. Wait for the favorable wind to swell your sail. Hurry, because you're taking me with you. Me, one of the three spirits of vengeance.
Woman. How much have I suffered, and how much more must I get?
Greeks rolled a huge structure built on four wheels into the city. And it was that structure which brought about my destruction and my miserable enslavement.
An enormous force, made out of mountain pine, chiseled by the sharp adze.
A construction whose noise reached the heavens,
whose cheeks were plated with gold,
whose belly was clogged with spears.
They left that horse by the gates of our city, and the folk saw it from above the walls and shouted with glee, "Come, people, come and see. Our troubles are no longer. Come, roll this holy statue to the temple of Athena, the child of Zeus."
So all the folk came out of their homes, young girls and old men alike, and with joy and song they pulled the devious destroyer of Dardanus' land inside the walls. All of them, all the Trojans rushed out to the gates to make this evil offering to the virgin goddess who rides the immortal horse.
How could this have happened?
They ran to the ambushing statue, spun plated ropes around it as if it were the black hull of a ship, and brought it to rest at the stony temple of the holy ground of the goddess.
That gift was fatal to Troy. And so the singing and the dancing went on all day until the day ended, as the black night began. The sound of singing, flute, and Trojan voices continued still in happy song, and the feet of the Trojan virgins still dancing with joy.
Bright moonlight flickered wide across the land, and inside every home it made the happy eyes heavy enough to sleep.
And it was then, the very moment I was singing and dancing in the temple of Zeus's daughter Artemis, the goddess of the hills, when the sound of murderous terror swung wildly through all the Trojan hills.
Babies threw their frightened little arms around their loving mother's skirts.
Ares, the god of war, emerged from his ambush.
Athena's dire work. At every altar, inside every Trojan home, the blood splashed.
Home girls in their deserted beds shaved their heads in grief.
Victory wreaths for the Greeks.
An offering of misery for Troy.
Hecuba, look. Look there. Andromache is coming. She's fighting with a foreign ladder.
At her sighing breast, her beloved child, Astyanax,
Hector's baby boy,
Andromache.
You poor old woman.
Where are they taking you with this wagon?
Look. Hector's bronze armor and all the Trojan spoils taken by the Greek spear.
Achilles' son will adorn the Sphinxian temples with them.
My Greek bastards are taking me away.
Oh, my darling girl.
Why, groan for me, Hecuba.
My girl.
Such suffering I must endure, Hecuba.
Oh, Lord Zeus.
Disaster.
My children.
All gone now.
All our joy is gone. Our Troy is gone.
Miserable fate.
Gone are all my noble sons.
Hecuba.
One evil fate after the other.
Evil fates indeed.
Miserable fates.
Our own fate and the fate of our city.
The smoke is choking our Troy. Children I bore from Priam, once you slaughtered so many Greeks. Come, take me down the halls to Hades.
We both desire the very same thing, my child. Both of us unfortunate, both of us beset by one disaster after another. Our city was destroyed, Hecuba, because the gods were angry with your son Paris, a man who should have been killed at birth. A man who, to satisfy his lust for a shameful bed, destroyed our Trojan fortress. The bloody corpses of
sweet solace in tears, in wailing and in the singing of dirges.
Hecuba, Hector's mother, the mother of a man who has killed many Greeks. Do you see all this?
I see, my child. I see that this is the work of the gods who wish to exalt things that the mortals think are nothing, and that wish to show us that they can destroy things that the mortals praise.
Look here, Hecuba. Look at me, and look at my son. My son and I are carried away like nothing more than spoils of war. The nobly born are turned into slaves. Fate has changed everything so much.
Fate is a mighty force, Andromache. Just moments ago, the Greeks took away my Cassandra.
Poor soul. It seems another Ajax has suddenly appeared to rob you of your daughter. And then you have more troubles to deal with.
Troubles, indeed. Endless troubles, no way to count them, no way to measure them. Troubles competing with other...
I have seen and know joy. I have always dreamt of achieving a good name, and there I have For me, even hope, that thing which every other human being has, even that, even hope has escaped me. Nor do I allow hope to deceive me. I know full well that I have no hope of ever seeing better days.
Your misfortune, Andromache, is similar to mine, and as you speak of your own fate, you speak of mine at the same time.
I know little of ships and sailors. So far, I've only seen pictures of them and heard a bit about them, but I've yet to step foot on a ship's deck. But they say that when a ship is faced with some storm, one that's not too violent, they work together quickly and eagerly to try and save their lives. One of them works the tiller, the other works the sail, and some even try to quickly bail water out from the ship's deck.
Now that is if the storm is not too violent. But if it is violent, if the waves of the storm swell and crash and overpower them, they abandon their ships to the wave, and they let fate do her work. And that is what I feel right now. The endless torrent of misery of the gods have crashed upon me, have overpowered my tongue, and I cannot speak. Gods have sent too great a torrent of misery upon me. So stop it, my darling. Stop speaking of Hector and of his fate now. Your tears cannot save him. Now you must respect your present master. Show him your kind nature and win his heart. If you can do this, then you will bring joy to many, many friends. And you will raise this child of my child, to be the greatest supporter of Troy. And in time, sons from your lineage may raise our Troy to be a city again. One concern leads to another. Who is this herald coming towards us? I wonder what new decisions he brings us.
Andromache, wife of the bravest of all the Greeks, wife of the now dead Hector, I have some bad news for you. News that I will give to you against my wishes, so don't hate me. These announcements are made both by the Greeks and the sons of Pelops.
How honest your words, Talthybius. Speak.
It concerns this child, Andromache. What words must I use?
Will he be separated from me? Will he be given to another master?
No. No Greek will ever be his master.
What? Will he be left behind, then? Here as a relic to the Troy that was?
I don't know how to break this awful news to you, Andromache. I don't know how to do this gently.
You show a kind heart to try and soften the blow of bad news.
The news is terrible. But I must tell them, Andromache, the Greeks will kill your son.
I have never heard news more painful than these.
It was Odysseus' decision, voted in favor by the rest of the assembly.
Will my pains never stop? Will the disasters never end? One dreadful misfortune upon another!
Odysseus had convinced the men that they should not let the son of a Trojan noble grow into a man.
Will they be just as convincing if it concerned their own son?
He's convinced them to have the child thrown from the Trojan towers. Let that happen, Andromache. You would be doing the wiser thing. Bear this misfortune with the noble courage you have. Don't insist on holding on to the boy. You're weak, Andromache. Weak and powerless. There's no one here to defend you. Both your city and your husband are gone, and your life is in the hands of others. How could a single woman possibly hope to fight against the Green Army? Think of that, Andromache, and don't fight against it. something shameful or outrageous. Throw no curses at the Greeks. I won't tolerate that at all. The moment you say anything against us, neither you nor your child will find any understanding from anyone. Stay silent. Bear your plight wisely, and your son will not be left unburied. And you too, woman, will be received by the Greeks more favorably.
My poor child. My darling son. Our enemies will murder you, and you will leave your mother all alone. Because you are a noble, the son of a noble and brave man who saved many but cannot save you. Disastrous marriage, dreadful wedding. You brought me here to Hector's palace, not so that I'd bear a son who'd become the sacrificial victim of the Greeks, but one who'd rule over all the people of Asia. Thank you.
crowning peak of your father's tower, where you will leave your last breath. It is an order. Take your...
but because I wanted to punish the man who treated my hospitality with contempt. A man who deceived me and stole my wife from within my own palace halls. That man now, that man and his country, have been punished. Greek spears saw to that. So now I have come for her. I have come for her. Uttering her name brings me no pleasure. For that Spartan woman, for that woman who I admit once was my wife. She's here now in these huts among all the other Trojan women prisoners. The soldiers who suffered so much fighting on her account left to me to either kill her here or, if I want, to take her back to Greece alive. I have decided not to kill her here in Troy, but to take her aboard our ships back to Greece and kill her there. Let those Greeks in Greece, those who have lost loved ones in this war, see and feel some justice. Right. Guard. Go inside the hut and drag the murderous bitch by the hair. Bring her out here, and when the winds are favorable, we'll take her back to Greece.
Oh, Lord Zeus, pillar of the earth upon which you have your throne, who you are and what you are is impossible for mortals to fathom. Hear my prayer, Lord, whether you are a human thought or natural law. Your ways are silent, Zeus, yet you drive all human affairs towards justice.
What?
Oh, Lord Zeus, pillar of the earth upon which you have your throne, who you are and what you are is
what do you mean by this?
Hear my prayer, Lord, whether you are a human thought or natural law. Your ways are silent, Zeus, yet you drive all human affairs towards justice. I praise you, Menelaus, for wanting to kill your wife. But let not her eyes fall upon yours. Let her eyes, the eyes that enslave all men, enslave their cities and set their houses on fire. Her magic spells are mighty. You and I and everyone else who has suffered know the power of her eyes very well.
This is a dreadful start, Menelaus. A frightening start, your thug has dragged me out here in front of these huts against my will. Yes. Yes, I know you hate me, but will you at least let me know if you or any of the other Greeks have made a decision about my future yet?
No. No major discussion is taking place about you. The army has decided, since it was me you hurt, I should have the power to kill you.
To kill me? Would I at least be allowed to make my case against this decision to prove that such a punishment would be unjust?
No, I'm not here to argue with you, Helen, but to kill you.
Let her speak, Menelaus. Let her not die without doing this, but let me be the one to put to her the other side of the story. Because you yourself know nothing of the true measure of Troy's suffering. Let her speak, and I can assure you that my story will result in her death. Fear not, she will not go unpunished.
A waste of time. But let her speak, if she wants. I give her my permission not because she has asked for it, but because of you, Hecuba. Because you have asked for it. Let that be made clear.
Well, in any case, since you see me as your enemy, you won't be responding to my arguments, even if they are just. So, I shall just have to direct my arguments against the accusations I think you'll be making against me. First of all, you should direct your accusations at her. It was she, Hecuba, who gave birth to Paris, and it was then when our troubles began. The destruction of Troy and of my own came about because of her husband, Priam, who should have killed Paris. He should have done
guilty of something dreadful.
First, let me represent the goddesses, and at the same time prove that this woman is a liar. There's no way that Hera and the virgin Athena would have lost their minds to the extent that the first one would sell Greece to the barbarians, and the second one would subjugate the Athenians to the Trojans. Nor have they ever gone to Ida to engage in some silly music.
Come, let's leave this place. My son will find you.
your body shaking in utter humiliation because of the evil deeds you perpetrated. You should be beaten with some modesty, not such crass haughtiness.
Well then, Menelaus, listen to the last words of my speech. They are directed at you. Kill her! Oh, it will be a crown of glory for Greece! And not only that, but it will set a precedent to all those women who disobey their husbands. Make it law! Death to all the disloyal women!
Menelaus, do justice to your ancestors and to your house. Punish Helen in a way that will show your nobility in the eyes of your enemy.
It will also scotch the rumor. A rumor that has been running rampant in the Greek camps that you are too much like a woman.
Now then, our words concur. Helen has fled my house of her own volition to jump into the bed of a stranger. Aphrodite had nothing to do it. Helen merely introduced the goddess into her tale to boast. Go now, Helen. Go now to the men who will stone her to death. Be a swift death. A swift recompense for all the drawn-out evil you committed against the Greeks. That will teach you to defy my name.
No, no! Menelaus, I beg you! I beg you, bow your knees! Don't kill me for something caused by the gods! Forgive me!
Don't listen to her, Menelaus! Don't you betray all those bastards of yours who died on her behalf! I beg you on behalf of those men, and I beg you on behalf of my son!
That's enough, old woman! I don't care at all what happens to her. Take her aboard the ship. Bring her back to Sparta.
In that case, Menelaus, don't let her get aboard the same ship as you.
Why is that? Has she gained that much weight?
No, but there is no lover who doesn't love his lover forever.
Perhaps. But it depends on the heart of the loved one. In any case, I shall do as you say. You won't be on board the same ship as me. You're quite right about that. Once we arrive in Greece, she will serve justice and she will die. Her death will teach all the other women to be sensible. Now, that certainly will be a difficult thing to achieve, but nevertheless, her execution will frighten the foolish women and the worst of the shameless sluts.
Altar and its altar, and the lush fragrance.
horrid Zeus, as they take me from my land, my eyes flooded with tears as they take me to be a slave in a foreign land.
Your daughter, Zeus, Helen will be holding a golden mirror.
A golden mirror. What a delightful toy that is for little girls.
I hope she never reaches her father's home into Sparta or Menelaus. I hope he never gets to the city of Patana, nor return to the temple of Athena of the Golden Gates.
Menelaus, husband of the most shameful woman in Greece.
Helen, who brought great grief and destruction to the streets of Samos.
Acastus, son of Peleus, king of Iolcus, had banished the boy's grandfather from the kingdom, and so he didn't want to waste any more time here. And so quickly set sail, taking Andromache with him. Her departure filled my eyes with tears. She wailed a heart-rending lament about her country and cried as she farewelled her Hector's tomb. She begged Neoptolemus to permit her to have this child, Hector's son and hers, buried. This child breathed his last after being hurled down from the towers. She also asked Neoptolemus that the shield not be brought back to Peleus' home. That bronze shield there had terrified us Greeks on the battlefield. Hector used to hold it up to protect the side of his body. She didn't want the shield hanging in the same home or the same chamber where she would become Neoptolemus' wife. That would be too distressing for Andromache, mother of this dead child. She asked him instead to bury the child in the shield instead of building a cedar coffin and erecting a stone tomb. She asked that the corpse be handed to you personally so that you could look after it appropriately, wrap it up in a shroud, put garlands over it. She couldn't bury the poor child herself since her master had to rush off so quickly. Once you've adorned the corpse, we'll come over and cover it with the soil and plant a spear in the grave. Hurry now and obey these orders. Oh, and I took care of one little task for you. As I was crossing the Scamander River, I stopped and washed the child's corpse and cleaned its wounds. We should work together to make this task easier for us both. The sooner we finish, the sooner we'll set sail for home.
Come! Put this bronze shield down here! Such a dreadful sight, my eyes can't bear what they see. Such a shameful epitaph for the Greeks.
It was all your father's inheritance, my darling. You've lost it all. Except this brilliant bone shield of his. It will be yours forever. You will be buried in it. Trojan tradition holds in high esteem.
voice of Hecuba.
You're whispering.
What are you saying, Hecuba? Tell us, Hecuba. We are your dearest friends.
We are with you.
It's obvious now, my friends. The gods. The gods only had one thing in mind when they caused all of this. To bring despair to me and hatred to Troy. To bring more hatred to Troy than any other city on earth. Some good is because of this. If the gods had not buried below the earth what once was above it, if they had not turned everything upside down, no one would have heard of us. The whole world wouldn't be singing about us. The muses would have no songs to sing to the coming generations of mortals. Come, you Greeks. Come and bury this poor boy's corpse in his grave. He has been prepared as well as he can be. Dead is a hollow display for the sake of the living. Poor child. Your poor unfortunate mother.
Poor Andromache. All her big dreams about you have been turned. Ashes.
So blessed when you were born, my child.
A prince.
A blessed prince.
So horribly murdered.
Look. Up there. Who are these men up there? Up on the roofs of Troy's houses.
They are waving lighted torches about. A new disaster is falling upon our Troy.
Servant in his country.